This old house once knew my children. This old house once knew my wife. This old house was the home and comfort as we walked the stone of life. This old house is a good people. This old house is neat to paint. Just like me, he's tuckered out, but I'm getting ready to be the same. Baby, church on Easter Sunday morning. God is so good. Let's look to Him. Father, we are thankful to be in the house of God. How good it is and blessed for brothers who dwell together in unity. God bless us today. Lift us up together. Bless the churches everywhere, oh God. Teach us thy ways and truth. Make this a house of worship. Help us to lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily beset us and press into that kingdom. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, when you got a cough drop about a half chewed up and you're trying to talk, it's kind of tough. But I've been sick. So I knew something was wrong with him. But I need a hug. God is good. Sister Judy, come on. Let's say.
Rescue.
Thank you.
Two times a year, that's what I'm trying to say. But we preach other things. But this is the greatest hope of the Christian world. And I this is spiritually discerned. And it is so spiritual that if you don't believe it, I couldn't talk you into it. And if you believe it, I couldn't talk you out of it. It's a spiritually discerned thing. It has to be revealed to you by His Spirit. I walked for years, had no idea what it was all about. I hated Sunday. And of course, back in my day, you didn't hear country music on the radio. It was gospel all day, day and night. Gospel. That's right. Stores wasn't open.
Nope.
We had blue laws. It's a Sabbath day.
That's true.
And they didn't sell booze on Sunday.
No, Lord, no.
No, you had to go out to the river bridge.
Yeah, bootleggers.
And you'd find them out there with 7-11. Little Joe from Kokomo, they'd be out there shooting dice and drinking beer every Sunday. That's where you, and from the road you couldn't see a thing. But you drive down, there's cars everywhere. Wonder how they got so many cars down there. That's where you had to go get you a drink or, you know, play a few games. That's where it was at. And I used to know an old guy who lived close to my house, and he was he would get drunk, and he'd preach a while, and then he'd cuss a while. he'd turn that radio on, he'd have that gospel music going, and he'd get with him, boy. He'd be saying amen, you could hear him halfway down the street. And he'd preach and preach, and then next thing you know, he's a cussing like a blue. I was just a kid. I used to hang around just to watch the show, you know. And that's how I got my start. We used to go down to the Marsville Tabernacle down on Marion Street, North Marion Street, and watch the Holy Rollers get happy. That was a big night for us, because I didn't watch the Holy Rollers. They didn't have air conditioning. The doors was open and the windows was open. And you could see them in there jumping and carrying on, and you could hear them in there. And so we went down and watched the Holy Rollers get happy. That was a big, big night for us. Had no idea what they was doing or what they was about. But one day the Lord got a hold of me. And my life has never been the same. And that's been right at 50 years ago.
Yeah.
And I was just a baby at the time.
Yeah. You forgive him, Lord.
Watch your mouth now. And Sister Betty Quakenbush had opened a new church down there. She was one of my favorite cousins. She was my wife's first cousin, second cousin. And so I had to go down and check out her new church, you know. And at that time, it was just a little shotgun church. You could look in front and look out the back, you know. It's expanded quite a bit since then. But the old socials, I went there to fight, but oh my, that night, something got a hold of me. And I didn't really go to fight. I just really went out of curiosity. And but something was planted in my heart that night that I couldn't get away from. And when I went home, it followed me home. And wherever I went, it followed me, and it nagged at me. And I was happy in my sin, and I was enjoying life in my sin. But there was something else going on. It was an awakening to something that I'd never experienced before. And I've never been the same. And it's as real today as it was 50 years ago, September of 1959. Seems like a long time, don't it? I said I was just a child. But something came awake to me. And actually, even before that time, some months before then, I wandered into a little church up on Douglas Street, the Evangelical Methodist Church. And I went in there that night because my uncle and his wife went there and their kids was in a Christmas program. And so I went to take in that Christmas play. And it was just a regular little Christmas program with, you know, the little wise men. And they had the star there and all that business. Just a very regular type of thing, what you see every year. But that night, something got a hold of my heart that night. Because I'd got married and things were kind of rocky in my experience. And you know, the Bible said that when they're old, they'll not depart from it.
Amen.
Raise them up in the way that they should go. When they're old, they'll not depart. I wasn't old by any means, but I was older. I was beginning to examine my life, and I began to realize whatever that was that we had that made a family, and that spiritual thing that held us all together. I can tell you the happiest days of my life was when my family was trying to serve God. And there were times that it was very nice. But they struggled with their salvation. They didn't understand grace. They didn't know anything about grace. I was raised up not knowing anything about grace. But I had a love for God. And I want you to know I've learned more about grace in the last 15 years than I knew the previous 35. And that's a fact. But they did the best they could. They just didn't know anything about grace. All they knew was law. Everything's law. God's going to get you for this. God's going to get you for that. I believe they made a song like, God's going to get you for this. God's going to get you for that. And that was the essence of their message. So you was guilty all the time. You walked in guilt. And you went to the church seeking something, and you felt worse you did when you after you went. But if you thought you was going to hell by the time they got done with you, you just knew it. And no need to even try it because you're a had dad, as they say, you know what I mean? And that's what I was raised in. I struggled with that. And even after God began to reveal grace to me, I had a hard time accepting it because we believed in that law. And since that time, I've had so many amazing experiences. I heard a Christian Jew talk about this very thing. What they call Messianic Jews, I think they call them Messianic Jews. That's those that have come to know Christ Jesus as the Messiah.
And
he said, it's amazing to me that we tried to keep that law for 2,000 years. We couldn't keep it, and now you Pentecost is going to keep it. So I've learned a lot since then, trying to find my way. These folks need a seat. Somebody be gracious.
I'd take the kids out of that
house. Help them find a seat. Oh, they'll take a knee on it, of course. It's good to see all of you with that as you made that.
Yes.
But it was a long trip for me to find grace. And to understand grace. I watched my daddy go through this. My mother, I told you, it was happy times in our house when they were serving God. But they never could do it for very long because they get discouraged when things didn't go right and it wasn't perfect and didn't measure up. And so they'd quit church. And then when they quit church, the war was on. My mother could cuss like a sailor and she could fight you just like a man. And they did a lot of that. And those times weren't happy times. But some of the fondest times of my childhood was times when they were in church trying to serve God. I watched people go through that thing. I've watched them in this church. I've watched some struggle. There's Brother Roger right now is is in the hospital, and there was a time he struggled with grace, finding grace. He would come, and I'd encourage him to bring his guitar and play, because he's a pretty good guitar player. And he would come for a while, and then he didn't feel worthy to even step on that platform. See, that's holy ground. Holy ground. It's boards and a rug, what it is. But wherever a holy person is standing, that's holy ground.
Yes.
Where you're at right now, when you're standing in worship of God, it's holy ground. I understand that now. And a lot of people have struggled with those kinds of, you can't have no sinners on your platform.
Nobody here.
Yeah, there wouldn't be nobody here if that was the case.
Exactly.
But the Bible said we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. See, I didn't understand that. I thought all them people up there was real holy, and I was way down here somewhere, you know. And that is the perception. That's what we grew up with. That was that's ingrained. And when that's ingrained in you, it's hard to get past that.
Oh, yes.
And you do fine, boy. Sometimes you're up, and I mean, you feel like you go bear hunting with a switch, and you really got the victory. At that time, boy, it's all right to be holy. I mean, you even feel holy, you know. But then when you get down a little bit, you get discouraged, and then your insecurity begins to set in, and you realize you're really not much. The Bible said at your very best state, you're altogether vanity.
Amen. That's right.
That's right. All of us, altogether vanity. And that's what we struggle with. The fact of the matter is, those that have been born again of water and of spirit, if you looked in the mirror when you combed your hair this morning or whatever, you saw your enemy.
That's right.
The one that'll keep you out of heaven, you looked at him, combed his hair, washed his face. Because the devil can't do it. His power's been broken. He was defeated. The Lord defeated him.
Sure did.
Kicked him around earth and then went down to hell and kicked him around the hell. He did. He defeated him. He took his power.
Amen.
In fact, the Bible said that if we'd draw nigh unto God and resist the devil, he would flee from you.
Yes.
That ain't much of an enemy, actually.
True.
But when we were in sin, we were of the devil. And the Bible said his deeds we would do. Because we were bound to do the works of the devil. Because we was controlled by the devil. We belong to the devil. But once we were set free, his power's broken over us. His teeth have been pulled.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
He can bark a lot, but he can't bite no more.
Amen.
So we can't blame it on the devil anymore. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the deacon, not the preacher, but it's me, O Lord. So the responsibility's here. That's where it's at. And it's upon you. Your salvation's on you. Well, I'd go to church, but I see these hypocrites one time. Well, I went to the church without a few hypocrites. I mean, you got to have a few hippos around.
Amen.
They're everywhere. Let me tell you something. Like I said, I've been around church 50 years. Very few people have I seen that are just absolute hypocrites. They are a few. They just don't have any intention of doing right. But there's very few of those. Most people really mean well. Regardless of how bad you see them fail, how miserable they are, and they may not measure up to your standard, but most of them really do mean well. And you know that's what counts in God's eyes. The Bible said His grace is sufficient. I had a sister tell me one time, she said, no, we are. Sufficient for what? You remember saying that to me, Jennifer?
Amen.
At that time, you didn't feel like it was sufficient at all, did you? Sufficient for what, Brother Pat? I said, anything.
That's right.
I don't see that, she said. I said, no, but someday you will see that. I will prophesy to you right now, someday you will see that. I was sitting right here, must have been a couple years later. She come in, shook my hand, said, I want to tell you something. I said, what? She said, His grace is sufficient. She found out His grace is sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what kind of roads He'll have to take you down to reveal Himself to you. And it may not be the roads I went down. It may be in some cases. But He's got a road you're going to have to travel to prove Himself to you.
Yes.
He will prove Himself to you. is God and there's none else. He wants to be Lord of your life. He wants to control your life. He wants to be the first one that you turn to, not the last one. So many people make him the last one. After their life's a wreck and a mess, they come stumbling back to God. He would much rather be the first one. He can save you a lot of heartache and a lot of tears. Amen. And I know in some cases I'm preaching to the choir today, but I'm telling you my experience. It took me years to understand the grace of God. His grace is unmerited. It's unearned. It cannot be bought. There's no gift big enough that you could give to be worthy of. There's no price you could pay. There's not enough good deeds for you to do. There's a lot of people trying to be good. You can't be good enough. It's good to be good.
Yes.
And most of us do for a while, or at times. We're good at times. Here, that song, he's a good old boy, they're good for nothing. This is good at times. He's good at leaving. He's good at leaving when the bills are due or something like that. He's a good old boy and I'm a good old girl, so I'll give him to you. Most of us are good at times and good for the most part. And most people really are. Most people want to do the right thing. But there's a compulsion within us that controls us. That's the power of sin. And we got to get that power broken. Amen. That power can be broken.
Amen.
And there's some in here could attest to you today and give you a testimony of how he's changed their life. We've got some in here that were mean people. One particular man I'm talking about right now, he was mean. Said, I hated people. His wife's nodding her head now, yeah. He hated people. He's such a love bug now, you wouldn't even believe that. He's a big old teddy bear, yes.
If I love
him, I personally love the man. He's a very lovable individual. And God loves him too. But he told me how mean he was. I couldn't believe it to see him now. But see, God changes things.
Yes, he does.
God can change a life. God can turn your life around. Now, he can't do it in spite of you. But he has a way of bringing you to it. And I don't know what you might have to go through, some of you, to get brought to it. but he knows what it'll take. And he's a good father. He don't give up on you. He's not like people. People give up. I'll tell you what, I ain't going to fool with them anymore. I fool with them till I'm not going to fool with them anymore. Thank God, God's not like that. He'll fool with you one more time. Because he's God. He's a good God. I love him today. As I read this I was thinking about, we were in sunrise service this morning. Some of us were, Raymond said. Mark, and I said some of us were. June 8th this year. He's hot. When you're hot, you're hot. You know, he's hot. He's hitting the lick now, so he's doing all right. But there's a lot of years he wasn't hot. I said this morning, and some people say, why do you do that year after year after year? Because the Bible said that to cling to that which is good.
Amen.
If it's a good thing, hold on to it. Amen. Don't give up on it. And it's tough, and it gets tougher every year. As you get older, you think it gets easier, but it don't. It gets harder. but we hold on to it because it's a good thing. And then later we say, I'm glad I saw it through. I'm glad I saw it through. There's something about seeing things through. Paying the price. It means something to God. Enter in, thou good and faithful servant, he said, into the joys of the Lord. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many. Praise God. So it means something to God to be faithful to God. He is a faithful God. I guarantee you can call on Him today and He's there. He's any hour of any day, He's there. He's available to you. But what's important is our faithfulness. He's looking for our faithfulness. And I was talking about how that said they came very early in the morning. And I said, what about you? But this is very early in the morning for me. Mm-hmm. And it was harder than it was last year.
Every year it gets harder.
Every year it gets harder, don't you?
Yep.
But June gave her testimony this morning. Amen. She wasn't even supposed to be here this Easter.
Nope.
She had a death sentence on her life. A miracle has taken place in her life. They told her she wouldn't be here. She's not only here, she's working.
Yeah.
Stick around here, we'll give you something to do. We won't let you lay around on your laurels, we'll give you a job. She's done a wonderful work. She ministers at the nursing home.
Yes, she does.
And they down there, they don't understand. They wrote her off a long time ago. You might go get ready because you ain't going to be around long. She said, well, we'll see about that. And she just plows on. Because she believes.
Amen.
She's got faith.
Yes, amen.
Simple faith.
I know what God can do.
Simple faith. If you believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. All things are possible to him that believeth. It's not to the wise, not many mighty, not many noble,
no.
Not to the rich, but whosoever will, let him come and take of the waters of life freely. And if you can but believe as a grain of mustard seed, it's so fine you have to look close to even see it, like a speck of pepper. If you can believe that much, you can ask what you will, and it shall be done.
Amen.
That's the thing we're working in, the realm of faith. It's a wonderful realm. It was all around me all my life. And I was blind to it. I didn't see it. God was all around me. I didn't see him. Guess what? I see him everywhere.
Amen. Yep.
I sing a song sometimes. I see him in a baby's smile. I hear him in the winds that sigh. He loves me and I know not why. He's everywhere. But see, when you're in sin, you're closed up to it. You're not alive to it. You're alive to lots of things, but you're not alive to that. But he's all around.
Amen.
He's ever near. All you have to do is call upon him. His word is true. I marvel at what these folks did. They came out, and why did they come out? If they didn't believe he was going to rise from the dead, why did they come out? Well, they kind of hoped. They wanted to believe. They was believing as much as they could possibly believe. He said he was going to rise again, but then again, he said he was going to be put to death, and they didn't understand that. You think about what these people had in their mind. Mm-hmm. He's come back, he's going to turn the world upside down, he's going to set up his kingdom, mm-hmm. And James said, I want to sit on his right, and John said, I want to sit on his left, or vice versa. They want a special, prominent place with him. When you come into your kingdom, let us sit on the right and left of you. Oh, they just knew he was going to kick them Romans out, kick their tail, kick them out. And then they took him and took him prisoner. Can you imagine how perplexed he was? We had faith in this. We believed this. That's what happens when you face what Judas faced. Lord, I tried to serve you. I tried to believe your word. And now here, what have I got? The big C. How can that be?
Yes.
But the old song says, this world is not my home. I'm just passing through.
Amen.
My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. This world, our life is but a vapor, it says, that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. I can tell you that's a true song.
Yes.
I look around some of these young people. I was 16 one time. Rocking in the bottom with a big, big grin.
That's my song.
Yeah.
I don't know where it went. It just
gone.
Gone with the wind.
Yeah, that's right.
It's gone with the wind. I'll never bring it back. But guess what? We're going to step in. We're into a place one day.
Amen.
And the time will be no longer.
Amen.
The angel will step out on the land and see and say, the time is no longer.
Amen.
There won't be any time. And we're going to be changed. The Bible said in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we'll be changed. And we'll put on a body like His glorious body.
Amen.
And we'll be like God.
Amen.
And we'll be elevated and we'll understand the mysteries of life. We won't no longer be perplexed or afraid. We won't, cancer won't mean anything to us anymore. Even the skeezics, the epidemic won't mean anything. The influenza won't mean anything. Amen. And that won't just be for 50 years or 60 years or 80 years. But it'll be forever and ever and ever without time. We have a hard time even conceiving of that. That's beyond our conception. But the Bible said it's not appeared unto man the things that God has prepared for those that love Him.
Amen.
We can't even imagine what it's going to be. But I'm going to tell you what, children, it's going to be better than this.
Oh, yeah. Amen.
We want to build big monuments here. We want to store up money, tear down barns and build bigger barns. And there's nothing here.
No.
Me and a sister was talking just the other day. There's a house up on Main Street. Used to belong to Arch Ratliff. You don't know who Arch was, but when I was a kid, he was a very prominent man in this town. He was mayor here for a couple of terms, way back there years ago. Owned a lot of real estate, was a very well-known man. And had the most beautiful home in the north end of Martinsville. And I remember as a child, I got let into his house and got to look around. I never saw such elegance in a house. Beautiful, beautiful woodwork, ornate, you know, like them expensive people have in their home.
Yeah.
I mean, beautiful, beautiful. You can go by that house today, it looks like it's ready to fall down.
Oh my.
It's in total disrepair. Somebody hadn't taken care of it. That's the hopes of this life. That's what you have waiting on you. That big beautiful yard out there, it really looks good. But you quit mowing it and see what it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that house you spend so much time painting on and fixing up, you let it go a few years without some paint, look what, see what it looks like. It'll rot down around you and the windows will fall out.
Uh-huh.
And that's the hopes of this life. That's the hope you have in this life. And there won't be no such thing as that over yonder. Amen. He's got a mansion for me. There's a mansion for me. A mansion for me. Built by my Lord on cruel Calvary. In those shining towers, my soul will be free. For Jesus is building a mansion for me. Hallelujah. Oh, I hope I can inspire you just to get a glimpse of it by faith, to see it as it really is.
Amen.
And to see what your life is. It's just a few years that'll appear for a little while and it's gone away. And all those things that you had confidence in. We've had in the last several years people that stayed with companies for years and years, and all of a sudden they went to Mexico. A lot of them lost their retirements.
Uh-huh.
That was a great hope and a great dream, you know, to retire. And you know, but it's gone and it's over and it's past. And it won't be back. It's not coming back. It's gone. Amen. And Paul said it way back there. If I had hope in this life only, I would be of all men most miserable. You can't have your hopes in this life. It'll let you down.
Yes, it will.
Friends will let you down. Loved ones will let you down. Your wife will let you down. Your husband will let you down. I guarantee it right now. They will let you down. They cannot measure up to what you need.
That's true.
Amen. They can be a benefit to you.
Absolutely.
And you can love them and they can love you and do the best they know how to do, but they're going to come short. Because there's something within man that man was born with. There's a big hole in your life that only God can fill.
Yes.
You'll find that out one day. Only God can fill that hole.
Amen.
And he wants to do that. He wants to, you know, he's a gentleman. Sister Daisy preached a message here one time about God is a gentleman. He will not impose himself upon you.
Amen.
You got to draw nigh to God. The Bible said you draw nigh to him, he'll draw nigh to you.
Amen.
He'll come down off his throne to you.
Yeah, he will.
Amen. He'll humble himself down, amen, and reach down to you. But if you don't be bothered, he will not bother you. Now, he may allow things to come along from time to time, kind of shake your tree and try to cause you to come, but he'll never make you obey him. It won't happen. Amen. And when I come to the knowledge of how bad I really did need God in my life, praise the Lord. And I thank God for what I found in him. A peace, a joy, a reality, something way yonder deeper than I ever knew. It don't take much to make me happy. No. There's a time in my life I just grabbed for this and grabbed for that and grabbed for this. And again, you ever watch kids on Christmas? I'm talking about people that's lost all idea of what Christmas is about. They open it up and throw it over their shoulder. And open it up. First thing, they got a whole room full of stuff stacked back there and say, is that all?
Yeah. That's not what I want.
I've had them say that to me. Is that it? Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. That's sad.
It is, but that's the way humanity is. Amen. But it don't take much to satisfy a satisfied soul.
Amen.
When you really are satisfied in your soul and in your heart, it don't take much to make me happy. My wife don't have to do a lot to make me happy, because I know she's just what she is, and that's all what she is, and ain't gonna make any more out of her. She does the best she can. Sometimes I shake my head and say, oh, I don't know about her. And you think that's bad? She has to live with me. Now I've just imagined what she said about me. But she puts up with me, and we assist each other. We're going to help each other get through this life. And it's really about what the benefit. It's all the benefits you're going to get out of one another. Is getting each other through this life, being there to help provide what you can. I believe the Bible said to render due benevolence under the one you love. And that's everything that you need from one another. You supply that. And you do that willingly and happily and without reservation, and you will be blessed. You will not be ecstatic, and you won't be in heaven all the time. That's why we have such cast-offs today, you know. Somebody does the least little thing, they just cast him off and go grab another. We've got to throw away society. He don't do just what I want him to do. Throw him away. Give me another.
Just as bad or worse, too?
Yeah, generally it's worse.
Probably worse.
It's generally worse. I read Ann Landers one time many, many years ago. Look at your dad. If you get one half that good, you're lucky.
That's about right. Most cases.
In most cases, that's probably true. And kids, you know, they want their mom and dad's got a home that they've worked 40 years for. Living in all kinds of shacks and things to get where they're at. But they're finally now they got it made and things are going well. And they're kind of reaping the benefits of all their hard work. And the kids come along and they think, oh, I have all that right now.
Yep. Yeah. I got a niece.
And like dummies, we try to provide it for them. And we all end up in a mess. That's the kind of a world we live in today. Well, we're seeking a city.
Yes.
A builder, a maker is God.
Yes.
Amen. We're seeking something way beyond this life. It's nice to have a nice home. I don't resent anybody a nice home. But I tell you, I lived absolutely one time in a tar paper shack. And you know what? I lived in it just like I live in the one now. I just lived in it. That's all you can do with it, live in it.
Right.
You can't eat it. It's not going to provide all the happiness you need in this world. I was told the folks here a couple weeks ago about this friend of mine's an optometrist, and he was having a midlife crisis, you know. And he used to play a saxophone. We played a band back in those days. He plays that. He'd go over, dance in front of the mirror and watch himself play. We used to love to get a kick out of it. He'd forget all about us. He'd see that beautiful guy in the mirror. He'd forget that. Playing the saxophone, you know. But he's a successful optometrist here in town. And I went to him to get some exam done. And he was crying on my shoulder. I tell you, Pat, I wonder. He said, I just wonder how many eye exams a guy can give. I give thousands of them. Now, he said, I got that big, beautiful home out there on the hill. And it's dark when I leave it. And it's dark when I get back home. I might as well have a motel room. All I do is sleep in it. It's nice. It'd make a nice picture for a Christmas card or something, you know. But that's about all the good I get out of it. And I said, man, you're having a midlife crisis. You're beginning to examine your life, ain't you? He said, I am. I'm beginning to wonder, have I been chasing the wrong thing?
Yes.
Gave me my opportunity to talk to him about what I've been chasing all these years.
Right.
See, I'm chasing another dream. It's not in houses and land and possessions and money and material things. But it's the peace of God and the joy of the Lord is our strength. And the confidence of God is with me every hour of every day, wherever I go, whatever situation I found myself in. Paul said, I've learned how to be content in whatsoever state that I'm in. And I've been in some states.
Amen.
But I've been in good situations. I've been where I could just write a check, write it out, get $10,000. And I've seen where I didn't have nothing. I mean, and it's all relative, you know what I mean? It's all relative to your situation.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of nice to have when you need it, but it's not something you ought to chase after because it could be gone tomorrow.
That's right.
But Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Mm-hmm. And it's, behold, I change not.
Hallelujah.
I can't awaken you to that, but I hope that maybe something I might say might stir your mind and cause you to just get a glimpse of it. If you can get a glimpse of it, God can lead you to it. I got a glimpse of it one time, and I saw something that I knew I didn't have. There was a big hole in my life I didn't have. And I began to seek after that, and God began to... The first thing I did, I moved back to Martinsville. I had a job, and I didn't even have a car, and I moved to Martinsville. Now I've got to figure out how I'm going to get to work. Well, I found a ride. You generally can. You have to. You'll find a ride, right? Rented this little house, a little shotgun house, 3 rooms, straight through. No windows, no curtains on the windows. Put newspapers up there. Didn't you have the money to get the utilities turned on and had a coal oil lamp? Just happy and full of the Holy Ghost. Never had more happy and had less in my life. Now, boy, I had the joy bells ringing and I had to get close to my church. I was within a block of my church. I walked to church. I don't know how I'm going to get to work in Bernadette, but I can get to church. But see, at that time, church was more important to me than the work was. Somehow, I don't know how to tell you to get to there, but somehow that's where you're going to get. Because I've had a lot of good jobs come and go.
Yes.
I'm still here. And still eating pretty good, as you can see. Haven't missed too many meals. The Lord's always took care. And he always
will. Yes, he
will. It's a matter of priorities. Because one day you're going to look up, believe it or not, and you're going to be 69 years old if the Lord lets you live.
Sure enough.
Or older.
Like Mark. Like Sister June.
And older, huh? Somehow we don't face reality. Oh, that'll never happen to me, or I'll never find myself in that situation.
Never say never.
Famous last word.
That's the truth. By the grace of God, Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God.
Amen.
And I say that also.
Lord.
I used to say in my ministry, and Jennifer's been around long enough, she can remember this. I've never been to hospital.
Yes, sir.
Oh, my.
How many times you hear me say that?
Oh.
I've been to the doctor in 15 years. And then one day I had open heart surgery. I spend a lot of time in now the hospitals now. I have a different take on that today. Life will do that to you.
God's still alive.
You can really have a narrow-minded position in some things. It's amazing. And a lot of times you hear people, they're real rigid in their thinking on certain things. A little time and a little trials, and they'll kind of soften up on that somewhere down the road. I used to watch it among the Pentecostal people. It was really tough on marriage. You know, back in them days, it was tough on marriage.
Oh, my.
And remarriage, I'm talking about. Remarriage, they were tough on that. Until their daughter or their son got a divorce. And then I noticed a kind of softening up in that position. When you have to live with something and face something, you have to go all around the situation to live with it. And that's what trials do to you. Why do I have to go through all these trials? Because you have to adjust to it. You have to find a way to go on. You got to find a way to reconcile yourself. And that old hard-headed thing you had, all of a sudden you got to soften that up a little bit, or you judge yourself out of this thing. I got to find a way to make it. I ain't trying to find a way to go to hell.
No.
And some people make such a mess of their life. Someone might say, well, I don't see any way for them. And I have to admit, I don't either. But I know the way maker.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know the one that can.
Yes.
And I don't understand. I even have to tell people, I really don't know what to tell you. People come to me for answers on things sometimes. I don't have any answer. I'm sorry. I don't know what to say to you at this time, but I'm going to tell you this. God is big enough for your problem. I know that.
Amen. It's bigger than any problem we have.
He understands your problem. I'm trying to, and maybe I can. I don't know. You know, it's just easy for me to say, well, that dummy, why did they get yourself into that? But then I look back at some of the things I've gotten myself into. What about that dummy? And if you live long enough and you struggle long enough, you'll find yourself in that situation. That's why the Bible said if we'll judge ourselves, we'll need not to be judged.
Amen.
Who art thou, old man, that judgeth another? To his own God, he standeth or falleth.
Yes.
We don't have any right to pass judgment on people. You may not agree with them. Best thing to do is keep your mouth shut.
Amen.
And want the best for them.
Amen.
You'll live longer and you'll feel better and you'll sleep better. And God might just bless you for having such a broad mind and a sweet heart about things like that. Now let me tell you something. You can be as hard as you want to on people, but God loves those people.
Amen.
Yes, he does.
Yes, sir. That sinner, you think, oh, God won't save him. God loves him. Now, you want to watch and see about God's people. I'm careful what I say anymore. I give God all the room in the world to be God. He can be God. Lord, you can be God in this. I'll not judge this. I won't have anything to say about it. I'll just let you be God. You know how, and I don't.
Mm-hmm.
And I may not understand it, and it may not be for me to understand. Believe me. I about decide there's some things in this life I just ain't going to understand. Until I'm changed.
Yes, amen.
In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, when I'm changed into the image of the Son of God, and I have the mind of Christ, I understand all mysteries.
Yes.
Well, that's going to be worth a trip to me. That's going to be worth the whole trip.
Amen.
That said, we'll understand all mysteries. Wow. Think about that. But until then, children, we are walking by faith.
Amen.
We're here by faith. We are where we are by faith. We do what we do by faith. There's some people just, they don't understand it. They were following some myth or something somebody made up. There's nobody can ever talk me into this. You could have the best argument you ever wanted to. You couldn't talk me into this. But guess what? You'll never talk me out of it.
That's right.
That I my eyes has been opened. I once was blind, the song says, but now I see.
Mm-hmm.
And until someone's seen that, you're just spinning your wheels and wasting your time trying to argue someone into it or to beat them into it, it won't work. It just doesn't happen.
Amen.
You can pray that God will reveal himself, and he can do that.
That's right.
And in a moment, God can give you enlightenment that you've been sick in your whole life. Let me tell you, I have preached some of the lamest sermons before. And then, my God, that's awful. And have somebody come to me after service, "Brother Pat, while you was preaching, God showed me something I've been seeking the answer to my whole Christian life." And I'm glad he did, because I don't think I deserve anything. But see, that's how I learned that this is his work. It's not my work.
Amen.
This is his gospel.
Amen.
He'll reveal it to whomever he will reveal it to. And he's able to. He's able to take my meek words, my seemingly can't seem to get said what I want to get said many times, just like that. Oh, I come on sometime with a big message, I'm going to blow them out of the building, this message today, and it just kind of goes kerplop, you know, just don't never do quite what I thought it was going to do. But somehow, God gets it said. I can tell you, when I went to church that night, I can't even tell you what was preached. I can't tell you what was even preached. But God planted something in my heart that went with me to my home. It went with me on my job. It went with me when I laid down at night. I never will forget that I was working two jobs, and I was killing myself. And I couldn't sleep. I was awake half the night and struggling with this thing. And I remember very well, after a Sunday night service, And went home and couldn't sleep. It was way up in the morning. I knew I had to get up in a few hours and go to work. And I'm dead on my feet, and I've been working 6 and 7 days. I'm saying, how am I going to do this? I'm dying. I sat up in bed and I said, "Lord, if you let me live till I get back to that little church, I will give my life to you." Laid down that bed and just passed out. Slept the whole day. Missed work. The factory went on, the business went on without me. But I knew I made God a promise, and I had to hold good to my promise.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. And when I went back to that little church, God got a hold of my heart that night. Amen. I found myself in an altar prayer. Yeah, amen. Thank God for an old-fashioned altar prayer. Got myself a snotty nose blessing. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And the old song said, "I'll never forget that night on my knees."
Oh, no.
The joy of that hour has never left me.
Hallelujah.
It's life's sweetest memory that death can't erase. I'm saved by his mercy.
Amen.
And redeemed by his
yes.
grace. Hallelujah. I go around singing it after all these years. That comes back to me.
Mm-hmm.
I'll never forget that night on my knees. That night I was born. I praise God for that great day. Jim, I love you today, and I didn't want to just fill your ears with just standard stuff that you read over and over and over. I want to talk to you about the revelation of God. Even some of you that's recently come back to the Lord, we've had some come back in our revivals and so forth. Listen, we grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord. We just don't jump from here to here. We have to grow into it. And as a little child has to learn to walk,
mm-hmm.
has to learn by progression. You can't take a little kid and get him up and expect things out of him that an adult does. Likewise, in God, you have to grow to find your place. Don't give up. Don't get discouraged. Amen. God's going to get you to where he wants you to go. You'll look up one day and you'll realize that I know a lot more than I once did. To the path that I've taken, to the things that I've suffered and struggled with, God has shown me the way. I'm going to talk to you about the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not just an unknown entity to me. I know him very well. I can tell you about him. And I can tell you he's full of grace. I can tell you that he loves you more than you love yourself. He understands where you've been. He knows where you're headed. And he knows how to get you there. And if you'll just learn to walk by faith and trust him, do what you know to do and do what you can do and put the rest upon him. Amen. He knows how to be Savior. He can be your Savior. He can get you there. And I'm not going to tell you won't ever have a doubt or a misunderstanding, but if you'll hold on to God and trust Him. You ever hear that song Garth Brooks sings about, I thank God for unanswered prayer? Do you ever hear that song? I thank God for unanswered prayer. Oh, there's been things in my life that I wanted so bad, and I went after too. But somehow God turned me around, changed my direction. And now as I look back on it, I wonder where I would be today if God hadn't rescued me from those unanswered prayers. So I too can say that I thank God for unanswered prayers.
Yes, amen.
If He'd have given some of us what we wanted, I just wonder where we would be. Oh, there's some people say, I want to win the lottery. And everybody does. I've tried to convince the Lord over and over that if He would let me win the lottery, I would just be so good to mankind and I'd do so many good deeds. Apparently, He don't believe me. Apparently, He thinks I'd just take that money and run, never stop running. Maybe I'm one of them kind. See, the Bible said we don't even know our own hearts, you know. So maybe I'm just scrubbing along because that's what keeps me going, you know. Maybe He's got me right where He wants me. And He's got me, hook, line, and sinker. I'm mad. I'm a broke mule. He already broke me. He knows how to break you.
Yes.
Yeah, He can break you. He's done broke me. I'm done broke. Praise the Lord. But I what I've learned about Him convinces me that He should take me all the way.
All
he
right.
can take you all the way.
All right.
He can answer every prayer for you. He wants to give you the desire of your heart. He knows how to do that. And the quickest way to get there is in obedience to God.
Amen.
You can go the scenic route or the closest way is a straight line, you know. Brother Ronnie said he follows it. Brother Lot, he was going to go to the church over Biogi, he was trying to find it. Oh, no, Brother Junior's church, that's where
Brother
we're.
Junior.
Yeah, and he was trying to find it. And Brother Lot said, well, you can follow me, I'll take you. And Ronnie said, my God, where all that man went, I don't know. We must have spent 20 miles going, you know, 9 miles. It's 9 miles over there. They must have went 20, 25 miles to get where he was.
Edinburgh.
How you went to Edinburgh, I do not know. But, I said he went the scenic route, but he got you there, you know.
Oh, we got.
There are a lot of ways you can go to Indianapolis. I mean, I can take you the, you know, the 50-mile route if you want to go that way, or we can get it on 37, go straight north, and you'll hit it pretty quick. And that's the way life is. We can get there the easiest way, or we can go the scenic route. And I want you to know something. God's got all the time in the world.
Yes.
We don't, but He does. And we just have to go how we have to go to get there. But I want to get there. Anybody want to get there with me? I want to get there. We can all make it. So you can make it. God is not against you. God is for you. He wants you to make it. He's not willing, the Bible said, that any should perish. He wants you to make it. He wants us all to make it. I'm glad to commend Him to you today. God bless you for coming out. We appreciate you so much.
When you get out,
and we'll give us back to Judy.
Have a
good day.
I read this the other day in our Daily Bread, and I'm sure a lot of you have these little booklets.
Yes, absolutely.
But this was on Wednesday, March 28th, and I actually tore it out and laid it by my chair so I could read it over and over and over. But I want to read it to you. It says, if anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Say the Lord had need of them. Talking about loosening the coat and taking it to Jesus. And I preached a message one time and I asked, how many is a donkey? And I was so surprised that everybody said, they were. You know? And the donkey was carrying the word. How many understand that? So you're a donkey in a sense, you're carrying the word. But this to me, I'm going to read it. It's for His triumphant entry into Jerusalem, Jesus chose a donkey to serve as His royal transportation. His disciples were instructed to say the Lord had need of it in Mark 11:3. Isn't it astounding that the Son of God should choose such a lowly means to accomplish His purpose? Alexander McLaren commended on this. Christ comes to us in like fashion and brushes aside all of the convenience excuses. He says, I am all your convenience excuses. He said, I've heard them all. He says, I want you, and that is enough. Talking about you. He wants you. Think of it. The creator of the universe needs us and desires to fit us into his eternal design. Though all powerful and not dependent on any creature, he has chosen to carry out his plan through the lowly human instrument. If this were not so, he would have taken us to heaven as soon as we were saved by his grace. He would have just took us off. We wouldn't have anything to do. But everybody's got something to do.
That's right.
Everybody's got a work to do. You know, none of us are called just to sit back and warm a pew, but we're out to do something. He said, you shall be witnesses unto me.
Yeah.
And then he says, someone once asked Francis of Assisi how he was able to accomplish so great a cast. This was a man that was so successful in the gospel. I know I didn't pronounce his name right, but just say a man. Put your name in there. And he said that, and he replied, this may be why. The Lord looked down from heaven and said, where can I find the weakest, littlest man on earth? Then he saw me and said, I have found him. I will work through him, and he won't be proud of it. He will see that I am only using him because of his insignificance. You may be small in your own eyes, but God has need of you. Did you ever feel insignificant? I mean, I'm just not able to do anything. You know, I can't sing, I can't preach, I can't do this. But you know what? There's something you can do.
That's right.
And God's looking for you. He's looking for you. But I know it's true because I think about my own life. And it was nothing. It was just nothing. Then the Lord came along. And I sing a song sometimes, makes a difference when Jesus passes by. And it does make a big difference when the Lord passes by in your life. And you realize that it's not you, but it's Him that's doing the work. Then you can be blessed in your deeds.
Amen.
Well.